Folks, how's it going? It is Freedom Tunes here, and I want to pull apart this article. Now, I don't normally do this, but let me give you a little background on our present situation. So you may be asking yourself, Seamus, why take time from your oh-so-busy schedule to do something as petty as rip apart an article? And the answer is this. This article makes a number of arguments that I've seen in other places that I think need to be taken down, and it displays a style of thinking that annoys me greatly. And also, to give you a little more background on this situation, I have a lady friend who is a libertarian. Now, I know what you're thinking. There's no such thing as women who are libertarians. And, well, for the most part, you're probably right. We tend to be white privileged males who are blinded by the society that upholds and defends our unfair advantages. And I know what else you're thinking. Seamus, how are you not about to wife this honey up, fam? A libertarian lady? How are you not making a move? How are you not hitting on this libertarian woman? Because she would fall in love with me. When you're like me, you can't just go around hitting on girls all willy-nilly. They fall in love with you, and then when you tell them that you're as free as a bird and can't be tied down, they write their name in your lawn with gasoline and carve phallic symbols into your car. This is based on real events. It's very hard being me. All right, I'm obviously kidding. I just got way off topic with this tangent. Here's what really happened. I have a good friend who is a female, who is a libertarian, who is personally opposed to abortion, but does not want it to be illegal because she doesn't think that would solve the problem. So we're dealing with a person who, for all intents and purposes, is pro-choice. And she read this article, and she sent it to me, and she said, Seamus, oh, Seamus, you handsome, handsome man. I just read this article written from a pro-choice perspective, and it was so stupid that it literally made me angry. Not annoyed, angry. And I thought, well, I'm in the mood to be angry. I'm always in the mood to be angry. As a traditional Irish Catholic individual, being angry is like my favorite pastime. So I read this article, and oh my, oh me, oh my, was it interesting. Let me give you a little history on this blog. John Pavlovitz saying stuff that needs to be said. Well, John, I'm interested in hearing what needs to be said, so hopefully your article will open my eyes. Okay, so before we dig in here, I know that a lot of the people who subscribe to my channel and who are fans are moderate liberals who are most likely pro-choice, and they come to my channel because they like seeing me tear apart regressive leftists, and that's entertaining for them, and we do agree on those points. But again, you know, if you are pro-choice, I'm sure we could have a very productive discussion on the ethics of abortion. And I would actually love to have that conversation with some of my fans. If you guys want to leave a comment, I'll do a live stream at some point. But you'll agree with me, even if you're the most adamantly pro-choice person out there, the arguments that this guy makes are just insulting to anyone with your position. So really, if you're pro-choice, you should thank me because I'm calling out the guy who's embarrassing you with these horrid arguments. Now, again, I still totally disagree with abortion, but there's better arguments than this. He actually doesn't make a single argument against abortion either. You'll see when we dig in. This is the article. Ladies and gentlemen, brace yourselves. This is the epitome of regressive leftist thinking and their inability to make anything that even resembles a legitimate, coherent argument and doesn't rely solely on emotional nonsense and sensationalism. Let's dive right in. White conservative Christian friends, I wish you were really pro-life. Aw. You tell me you're voting for Donald Trump for one reason, because you're pro-life. Okay, so first of all, it's an article on abortion. We've already jumped right into Donald Trump. There's a number of things that regressive leftists have to mention, or they're going to explode. So, like, you know how vegans need to tell you that they're vegan, and like people who do CrossFit need to tell you that they love CrossFit? Like, people who are regressive leftists need to tell you that they don't like Donald Trump. The moment they meet you, they're holding their breath. How long am I going to have to go without telling this person I hate Donald Trump? First line in the article. So, despite everything you know about this man, much of which you openly lament, you say you can't support someone who doesn't share your burden, and that you're voting solely on this issue. Life, you say, is the ultimate deal breaker. I wish that were true. Oh, he wishes that were true. I don't actually believe you're pro-life. I believe you're anti-abortion. which is a far more selective and convenient defense of humanity. Oh no. Wait, is he telling me I'm not pro-life? Oh man, I wonder what I do believe. Man, how am I ever gonna know what positions I hold without John telling me? I mean, with me not knowing my own positions and mind reading being impossible, who's ever gonna clear up this dilemma of what I actually believe? Unless, are you a mind reader? Can you read minds, John? Oh, well, please read mine, because I'm begging to know what I actually think, John. See, this is why you're the guy who says stuff that needs to be said, John. Thank you, John. From where I'm standing, it seems as though for you, life, which is in quotes, because we're debating, I guess, what life is, compromises a very narrow demographic, one that bears a striking resemblance to you. The unborn are easy to advocate for because you can idealize them into something palatable to you, something benign and comfortable, something in your own image. First of all, that's totally untrue. Whether you're pro-life or pro-choice, I think it's pretty obvious that fighting for the right of the unborn to live is one of the most difficult things you can do because no one has ever interacted with an unborn person, so very few people have an emotional connection to them. So it's actually way more difficult. You see, it's not that you're pro-life. You're pro-straight white Christian fetuses. Oh my God. This is like a parody. You can't make this up. All right, first of all, how can a fetus be Christian? How does that happen? They're not even baptized by that point. Straight also, I care nothing for the sexual orientation of said fetus or its skin color. And by the way, sir, proportionally and statistically, far more black unborn children are aborted than white ones. So we're kind of fighting for all of them if we're against abortion. On top of that, here's what's very bizarre. So, okay, if we were only in favor of white Christian fetuses, why would we ever want abortion to be illegal? Because Christians aren't supposed to be having abortions anyway. Wouldn't we be fine with anyone else having an abortion besides Christians? And wouldn't we be like, well, our Christian morals say we shouldn't have abortions, and the only Christians who will have abortions will be fake Christians, so all the real Christians are giving birth to their children. What's the point of even banning it? You see how this logic falls apart very quickly? If we only wanted white, straight Christian fetuses to get the chance to exit the womb and live a full life, we wouldn't be in favor of abortion restrictions because Christians who actually take their faith seriously don't have abortions anyway. But that's neither here nor there. I can tell by how often your heavy burden for the sanctity of life evaporates upon delivery. In so many cases, this compassion really has a 9-month expiration date, as if life begins at conception but ends upon leaving the birth canal. That's exactly what we believe. That's why we're in favor of post-birth abortion and infanticide. We're all about that. The completion of the third trimester is actually the shelf life of your passionate regard for much of the living. That's interesting. So this is a person who I'm sure doesn't actually know any serious pro-lifers, because as somebody whose family was heavily involved in the movement, my parents actually used to find homes for the children of women who had unexpected pregnancies. So the idea that pro-lifers only care about the unborn until they're born, man, is just total nonsense. I get that there's a lot of pro-lifers who don't actually go out there and try to prevent abortion and who don't actually try to help these poor women find homes for their children when they have an unplanned pregnancy. But by the same token, how many people who are in favor of importing people from the third world are interested in housing Syrian refugees at their property? Very few. Let's move on. Because if that life is, as you say, a treasure, one day converts to Islam, you'll label it dangerous, see it as a threat, and applaud its, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh wow, this, ugh. Okay, he's already wrong in so many ways that I don't even know where to begin correcting him, and this is just me referencing the mistakes he's made in a single sentence. First of all, Islam is a belief system. You can believe that certain belief systems are dangerous because you very clearly believe that the pro-life belief system and the conservative belief systems are wrong, and that doesn't make you bigoted. It just means you have a different point of view. So if my point of view is that Muhammad was not the prophet of Allah and that Islam is not the highest moral code and that a man who was essentially a Middle Eastern warlord is not the epitome of how a moral human being should behave, then I should be a little bit afraid of Islam. That doesn't mean I should hate Muslims as people. And that certainly doesn't mean that I don't think their life is valuable. So this is a ridiculous straw man on all fronts. And not only that, but again, this has absolutely nothing to do with the argument as to whether or not an unborn child has the same rights to citizenship and life as anyone else in society. And I'm not saying that that's necessarily an easy discussion to have. I'm sure a lot of my fans are pro-choice, and I'm sure we would go back and forth on how we would best solve the dilemma of the fact that there are so many unplanned pregnancies in today's society and so many children who, it appears at the surface, are unwanted. But the idea that radical Islam has anything to do with any of this is a connection that only a regressive can make, because he's going to try to pack in as much virtue signaling as he possibly can. If that life eventually comes out as LGBT, you'll condemn its soul, harass it in your workplace, in your church, try to prevent its marriage, tell it where and when it can use a public bathroom. So I don't value your life because I think men should use the men's room. It's so traumatic and horrible that I think men should use the men's room, and that I would deny you to go into the bathroom that you identify with, I may as well think it's okay to kill you. This is how melodramatic and ridiculous these people are. You bully it and drive it to suicide. Oh, wow. All right, so I'm already noticing a pattern with what he's doing. First of all, he's displaying a total lack of nuance on every single issue that he's brought up. He takes something like the pro-life movement, and because many pro-lifers are conservative, he connects that to conservatism. And because many conservatives are traditionalists, he connects that to traditionalism. And because traditionalists oftentimes believe marriage is between a man and a woman, he connects it to believing marriage is between a man and a woman. And because many people who believe marriage is between a man and a woman think being gay is sinful, he connects that to thinking it's okay to bully gays until they commit suicide. So let's be clear. This is his argument against the pro-life movement. Hey, I'm pro-life. You're pro-life? Well, guess what? It's not okay to bully gays until they commit suicide. Have you considered that? Ooh, good point. Wow, you never thought of it. And although he's acting as though there's just this group of people that is openly okay with bullying gays until they commit suicide, that this is our stance, this is one of the cornerstones of the pro-life movement, like, all humans are entitled to life, we should make it easier for people to adopt children, we should bully gays until they kill themselves, we need to make sure hospitals provide mothers with the tools they need to raise their children. Did I miss anything? Guys, I'm so glad I read this article, because I actually thought that it was okay to bully gays until they commit suicide. But John let me know, and this is why John says what needs to be said, you guys. This is why John says what needs to be said. Leftists love talking about nuance. They are the least nuanced human beings on the planet. Not only does he not understand that you can be ethically opposed to a behavior such as homosexuality without believing it's morally acceptable to bully a person who exhibits this behavior until they commit suicide, not only does he realize that not all conservatives believe that marriage is only between a man and a woman, and not only does he not understand that not all pro-lifers are conservative, he doesn't understand that you can be pro-life without thinking it's okay to bully a gay person until they commit suicide. Two concepts which have literally no connection or relevance to one another, other than the very tenuous one he's drawn between this string of principles that are all very loosely related. Hey, Ace.
Hey, Seamus.
You need to leave. Leave! I'm recording a video right now, just letting you know, babe. I'm yelling at an article.
I'm yelling at you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am!
Dude, you're right. That's a good point. You don't have the nerve to yell at me. Get in your room and close the door.
I'm going out.
Where are you going?
To the park.
I didn't give you permission. Who the hell are you going to the park with?
What?
Who are you going to the park with?
Myself.
Your
jog.
Are you serious right now? So serious. Ace, you've never gone on a jog in your life.
I'd go every time you're not here.
Are you serious? I would like to be invited for a jog. I believe it's pronounced yogging with a soft J.
Yogging?
Yogging, yes. Hey, Ace.
What?
Did you know that it's not okay to bully gay kids until they kill themselves?
What?
Did you know that that's true? Did no one tell you?
No, no one told me.
Well, I'm reading this article. Here, come out here. Come on here real quick. I'm reading this article, and it mentions that it's wrong to bully gay kids until they commit suicide, and that's why you shouldn't be pro-life.
I did not know this.
Yeah.
I thought it was okay to bully kids until they kill themselves.
That's what I thought, too. This guy, ooh. I'm really rethinking being pro-life now that I know it's wrong to bully gay kids until they kill themselves. Oh, wow. Well, this guy named John Pavlovitz, I believe is how it's pronounced. He wrote this really eye-opening article, which enlightened me.
He deserves a medal.
I think this guy should get the Nobel Peace Prize
for real.
For protecting gay life.
He's saving millions.
Now get out of here. Close the door. I'm recording. That's me scoffing at you. Let's get back on track. If that life has brown skin and wears saggy pants and gets gunned down during a traffic stop, you'll not only have little grief over its loss, but readily blame it for its own execution. Wow! Total link right there. Total obvious link. I'm glad he pointed it out. Okay, first of all, he's not wrong that there are cops who are racist or will identify or profile black people, but he's clearly alluding to Mike Brown. Mike Brown, who reached for a police officer's gun. Folks, I am as white as snow, and I would never reach for a cop's gun and expect to live. Because first of all, get your own gun, you mooch. Second of all, cops tend to shoot you when they feel their life is threatening. When they feel their life is threatened. I'm sorry. Look, I made an oopsie with my words. So there's another tactic in here that I noticed people on the left really, really love to use. Whenever you explain to a leftist that an injustice has not occurred, they accuse you of rationalizing the very injustice that never took place. So, for example, let's say, women were getting paid less because they were working fewer hours. And they said that was an injustice. And you explained that it wasn't an injustice because if you work less, you don't get paid as much. They respond with, you're blaming women for the injustice that's occurring? You're blaming them? Or let's say, you reached for a cop's gun and got shot. And they thought that was an injustice. And you explained that it actually isn't because that cop has to get home to his family. you're blaming women for injustice? No. It's tragic that someone died. It's always sad. It's not an injustice. That's what happens. So just always remember that in conversation, because this throws people off a lot and they get confused when they point out that a supposed injustice that the left trumps up isn't actually occurring based on the facts or statistical information that they've brought to the table. The leftists will almost always accuse them of not taking the issue seriously enough, being unsympathetic to those who are suffering, or blaming those affected by the injustice for the injustice itself. While in reality, they're actually just pointing out that no injustice is occurring and that we should focus on something else. Whenever you use facts or statistical information or empirical evidence to point out to a leftist that an injustice has not occurred, they will always accuse you of rationalizing said injustice, as opposed to evaluating their own position, reevaluating it, and admitting that they were wrong because the evidence says they're wrong. They will accuse you of rationalizing the wrongdoing. You're blaming whoever is suffering. And blame is a mean word. Oh, I don't want to blame people. Blame? Ooh, that has a sting. If that life is strapped to a prison gurney and pumped full of drugs that will cease its lungs from expanding while its terrified mind comprehends it all, you celebrate the occasion as justice being served after the last meal you resent having paid for. No, it's true. Yeah, the pro-life group at my church, they actually get together every time there's an execution and have a little execution party. You got your last meal? Well, guess what? We're having our own meal. And we don't mind paying for this one. This is a crazy celebration. They play celebrate good times, come on. And we're all partying and stuff. Yeah, someone's dead. No, all right, first of all, not only are many pro-lifers against the death penalty, myself included, I'm totally against the death penalty because I don't think the state should have the power to decide who lives and who dies. But even so, you can believe that the death penalty is a morally acceptable way of dealing with the problem of crime without that actually being totally logically inconsistent with your pro-life values. Now, I know how that sounds. It sounds hypocritical. But again, I'm playing devil's advocate, speaking from the point of view of somebody who actually is against the death penalty in everyday life. I'm totally against the death penalty, and I want to make that clear. But leftists love this pseudo mic drop moment where they say, if you're pro-life, then why are you in favor of the death penalty? Oh! Boom! Oh, damn. Oh, you showed them what an original observation no one's made before. You're brilliant. Okay, well, first of all, not only am I against the death penalty, but even if I wasn't, let's flip the table on this. As somebody who's in favor of abortion but against the death penalty, you believe that if a woman is raped and becomes pregnant and we catch the rapist, the most appropriate way for society to deal with this is to kill the unborn child. But it would be unspeakably evil to kill the rapist, the only person in the situation who's actually done anything wrong. Because that would be mean. Now, I don't mean to be flippant because, again, I am against the death penalty. But am I the only one who sees a contradiction there? They always claim as though they're morally superior because they see that it's wrong to kill somebody in a situation, even where they've done something horrible. And one of the arguments they almost always use is, yeah, you're pro-life now, but I bet you'd change your mind if your 16-year-old daughter got raped and was pregnant. Yeah? Well, how's this sound? You're against the death penalty now, but I'm pretty sure you'd change your mind on that too if your 16-year-old daughter got raped. Ooh, look at that. Hadn't considered that before, had you? With all that nuance rattling around in your head. Give me a break. If that life has to endure its formative years in an overcrowded, grossly underfunded public schools, you'll tell it to pull itself up by its own bootstrap. Well, nestled in the cloistered, private gated community of suburbia where bootstraps come with a birth certificate. Wow, that's interesting. I forgot that I live in a gated community. I forgot that all pro-lifers live in gated communities. I just love the caricatures he's creating here. Ace, you need to leave.
I am.
You're a bacon boy.
I'm leaving my key.
Why?
I don't need pockets.
I won't if you. How long are you going to be gone?
Probably the late.
What the hell, Ace? Go! Go and be back! Be gone with you! Bagosh! If that life... Alright, so now he's just trying to cram in every way he can virtue signal. First he told us that he's in favor of gay people, then he told us he's in favor of black people not getting shot by police. So obviously at this point all this guy's trying to do is squeeze in virtue signaling for every group he possibly can. First he informed us as to his very brave and controversial opinion that it's actually wrong to bully gay kids until they kill themselves. Then on top of that he threw in another unacceptable opinion, which is just rattling people's minds that it's wrong for cops to shoot black people for no reason other than the fact that they're black. And let's see what this next one is. If that life has working parents who can't make a living wage, you'll label it lazy and a lazy, unproductive drain on the system, always looking for handouts and trying to work the system to its advantage. So again, this is him totally mischaracterizing the anti-war on poverty position. Most people are against the war on poverty because they don't actually think it helps the poor, not because they think poor people are lazy or bad or of a lower moral caliber than anybody else. So let me just break this down for everybody who hasn't caught on to this yet. This guy wanted to write an article refuting the pro-life belief system. And not only did he not actually represent any of the pro-life arguments properly so that he could debunk them, not only did he instead choose to argue against positions that have nothing to do with being pro-life and are just tenuously linked by the American two-party dichotomy. But when it came to those positions, he didn't even accurately represent his opposition on them. So when arguing against the pro-life position, he didn't even strawman the pro-life position. He strawmanned the anti-war on poverty position. And he strawmanned the anti-gay marriage position. If he thinks he's accurately summing up a person who believes in traditional male-female marriage as someone who believes that it's okay to bully gay kids until they kill themselves, and that this is somehow an accurate argument and sufficient argument against abortion, he's either totally morally insane, has no idea what he's talking about, or is trying to virtue signal, and it's likely a little bit of all three. So again, he's taking all these worst case scenarios of what may happen to somebody in a society where the government isn't giving them everything for free, and he's saying a person could die in this situation if you don't give them what I'm saying you should give them, and if you don't give the government the control that I personally believe the government should have. Therefore, in your mind, you must have nothing but contempt for that person and believe it's okay to kill them from the get-go. So I don't know why you're supporting the pro-life position in the first place. Well, good sir, it's actually possible for me to want to help those disadvantaged in our current society without agreeing that your solutions are the proper ones. But of course you didn't consider that, because as you have clearly displayed from what you've written in less than 300 words, you are one of the least nuanced human beings walking this earth. Maybe that's a bit harsh. There's plenty of other regressives out there, but you are displaying a total lack of understanding of any of the positions that you're trying to argue against. And again, none of those positions are even the pro-life position. If that life is sexually assaulted, you'll blame it for promiscuity and immodesty. Again, none of this has anything to do with when human life begins and whether or not abortion is a necessary evil or should be banned, or is a moral good, or whatever other argument can be made by somebody in the conversation on the sanctity of human life and abortion rights, and what that means and how they relate to each other and whether or not one can exist without the other. It's a complicated discussion. And what insults me is that he didn't just do a caricature of the pro-life movement. He did a caricature of every other movement besides the pro-life movement to argue against the pro-life movement. None of these things have anything to do with abortion. So basically, here's what he's saying. And then the way this article, you'd want fewer guns in the hands of kids and criminals, blah, blah, blah. You'd want to prevent sexual assault. So here's what he's doing with the end of this article in his ultimate and final virtue signaling. He's listing a bunch of bad things that, oh, he's against. Oh, well, what do you know? He's against the bad things in society. And if he's against the bad things and I don't agree with him, I must be in favor of the bad things. Oh, no. That makes me of a lower moral caliber than John Pavlovitz. I wish I was as good as you, John. So he's like, okay, so you think abortion is wrong, but guess what? Other bad things happen in the world, and I'm going to find some way to link them and make you responsible. You're against abortion? Well, guess what? People are stepping on Legos every morning. Why aren't you speaking out against that? When I was 3 years old, my uncle got shot with a gun and died. And you know who likes guns? Conservatives. And you know what conservatives usually believe when it comes to abortion? They're pro-life. Therefore, pro-life people killed my uncle. And you call yourself pro-life? You make me sick. I can do this too. I could do this very easily. You're pro-choice? Well, guess what? Donald Trump used to be pro-choice. You love Donald Trump. Oh! So he's just super duper nuanced when it comes to abortion, and he says, hey, you know, technically speaking, I can be personally against abortion but not think that the government should be involved. But when it comes to poverty or healthcare, he says, hey, you can't be personally against poverty but not think the government should be involved. What's wrong with you? Do you hate poor people? So it's just a lovely double standard. I'm a person of life. That is what my faith calls me to be. I don't celebrate it when a woman terminates pregnancy. I honestly don't know anyone who does. I think I know some people who celebrate when a woman terminates a pregnancy. The people who make a shit ton of money when women terminate their pregnancies. But no, that's just cynical. No one's trying to make money. My advocacy for life goes well beyond the womb and includes a far more diverse swath of humanity than those who look, speak, or worship the way I do. It includes immigrants and Muslims and atheists and my enemies. Wow, John, that's real deep. I'm starting to think that maybe I shouldn't hate Muslims and atheists. You know what I love this? You know what I love about this, though? He calls out atheism as though, because he's a left-leaning individual, he can just use atheists as a token. Look, atheists are left-leaning, and I'm left-leaning, so I speak for atheists. No, you don't. Most atheists I know would be just as disgusted reading this article as I am. A lot of my fans are atheists, and they're sick of the regressive nonsense. And that's why we can come together and agree. You realize that on the topic of what you just mentioned, Islam, atheists and Christians are actually uniting and agreeing with one another to a certain extent on how they can combat useful idiots like you. Don't act like you speak for atheists, dude. I am pro all life because it is all sacred, not only when its heart begins beating, but when it beats and when it but as it beats and when it struggles to beat up until it ceases to beat. Oh, wow. I defend all life equally. I celebrate it all fully. I protect it passionately. I really wish you did too. Oh, John's challenging me to be better. Well, John, here's the thing. I am pro-argument, not because I like to make people upset or angry, but because I like to put forth opinions based on empirical evidence and facts that will challenge someone else's worldview and actually add something of value to the dialogue. I defend all discussions, and I celebrate them fully, and I protect them passionately. And I think that people should say things that mean something when they open their mouths. I really wish you did too, John. Let's read the comments. Kevin says, excellent!
Excellent!
This is beautiful. I have a sneaky feeling that even if all Christians were as good, holy, and generous as John thinks he is, he would still vote pro-abortion, probably. Whew, that was painful. Let's look at some of his other articles. I'm with her. Oh, wow. Modern left-leaning Christians who do nothing but virtue signal to their other leftist friends that they're one of the good Christians. You guys are little bitty Uncle Toms. Everyone knows it. It's super annoying. Please stop. Please stop. Oh my gosh. It's so disgusting and pathetic. And I do disgusting and pathetic things too. Like, I'm not here to judge. I'm not a great person. I'm never going to claim to be a great person. But my arguments are better than yours, John. I'm telling you. Like, I understand that a lot of people are just misguided and they've been sold this meme that Christians aren't supposed to judge and that judging is the exact same thing as making a value statement on whether or not a particular action is moral or immoral. So if you point out that anything is wrong, which the Bible says many things are wrong, then you are a judgmental person, so you're not really allowed to do that. But this is obviously total nonsense. Scripture actually encourages you to call out immoral behaviors when you see them. But we have a set of new modern hip Christians who want to tell us how mean and immoral we are, but the irony behind all of it is that they're the most judgmental of all. Because their highest commandment is thou shalt not judge. But let me add a caveat. Thou shalt not judge unless you're labeling all of your serious conservative Christian friends as mean and judgmental so that you can virtue signal to your leftist friends that you're one of the good Christians. Maybe I was a little harsh. Maybe I was a little angry when reading this. And I don't like being a jerk to people. You know what? Actually, to be honest, I'm sure John Pavlovitz is totally a cool guy. And I mean that. I'm sure he's someone I could grab a beer with and talk to and have a conversation with. Because people don't actually talk like this. And I'm pretty certain in real life, John is not spouting out this nonsense. Maybe he is. And if he is, that's unfortunate for him and everyone around him. But whenever we're not actually communicating with another human being, we're sitting at our computer writing, we are a lot more snarky than usual. And that's the truth for me too. I was more snarky in this little takedown of his article than I would be if I was having a conversation with the actual man, because the internet sort of removes empathy from the equation. So I suppose I should apologize for that. But the truth of the matter is, John, you're totally wrong on all these points. Totally wrong. Totally wrong, man. And if I made any personal attacks in this video, I apologize for that. But John, so much is just wrong with what you've said. I would love to have a conversation about it. All right, thank you so much for watching, guys. Like, subscribe, donate, please. Patreon.com/freedomtunes. I upload a new cartoon every Thursday, and I'm also going to start doing streams like this where I read and tear apart things that make me angry because I need to vent, and I'm sure you guys like extra content. So thanks so much. Give me feedback. Love ya. Oh, Morty, stop the broadcast.